before the troubles began, we have scant memory of what the city was like, and it had a very strong sense of community. As children, you're acutely unaware of the poverty and deprivation and overcrowding that you live in, but you became more aware of that as you got older. But when the troubles began, then very quickly we began to understand something of the political climate in which we lived in.
I started to join the civil rights marches and in support of what we were trying to achieve. And naturally, out of that, we had, at times, trouble began.
The word troubles was a word quickly implanted at the very beginning of the conflict. You know, they used this term troubles as to almost say, well, it's not as bad, it's just trouble. You know,
we didn't have any real entertainment, we didn't have concerts, we didn't have anything of that nature. And our sport and our form of entertainment took the form of riots, which for a lot of us were great fun, until the British Army then began to really put the pressure on and, you know, kill with plastic bullets and rubber bullets. So we were under no illusion very quickly that it wasn't fun, that this is a matter of life and death.
I was a young boy, born in the 60s, so I would go to school where the soldiers would stop and search our school bag. You know, I would be, you know, going to the town and we were put up against a wall and frisked. You know, every family would have some member that would be in trouble at some stage. And these were normal, everyday children.
When I was shot and blinded by the rubber bullet, I was not only knocked over physically, but I was knocked on a journey. You know, when you really look at what happened that day, a 10-year-old boy blinded at the bottom of the school playground on my way home from school. Overnight, the lights went out in my life in terms of eyesight. But yet and all, I bounced back from it.
And that was my cousin. She was 14 years old, and she was shot dead by the army. And she stepped outside the door and she was hit twice in the head and killed instantly by the army. I'm not going to be bitter about it. I'm not going to sit here and say that the British soldier deliberately targeted her or shot her. I can't say that. But nonetheless, she did get shot by the army.
My own brother, Michael, was murdered on Bloody Sunday. And I've been involved in the campaign to vindicate and get a declaration of innocence for all who died and were injured on Bloody Sunday.
The pavements outside all the front doors was dug up and broken up and used as missiles either the British Army or the police, or they build barricades across the road. So you take an estate like the size of Craigan with 15,000 people in it, and the bog side as well, you know, with barricades across each street, rubble barricades or burnt out vehicles. You know, derelict buildings that have been burnt out in riots and stuff like that there. Army checkpoints, military patrolling the streets, bombs gone off. It was a war zone.
People started to die. The British Army started to kill people. The IRA retaliated and they killed people.
It was a war, and it was a war that lasted for an awful long time, generation after generation.
Now, one of the greatest days of my life, apart from what marrying the wife, was the 5th of June in 2010. When after all the work that we put together, we had a report by Lord Savile who cleared all our people's names. They were all vindicated, were all declared innocent.
On behalf of the government, indeed on behalf of our country, I am deeply sorry.
No, I was there the day that David Cameron apologised. I was in the Guildhall Square. And there was a great sense of healing, you know, a great sense of something really significant has happened.
I believe healing began within the city, but also I think it helped get the city of culture, UK city of culture. I do believe that.
I think it was a great decision to give it to Derry, a city that is, you know, away from the normal centres of access of creativity and culture, and a place that, you know, needs a helping hand really in terms of, you know, after the troubles that that the city has been through over the years. Culture can be a real healing process and can be a real stepping stone to prosperity and happiness.
We didn't have to make up culture, we didn't have to pretend to be something that we weren't. And there was so many strong activity already happening. The cultural identity in the city is extremely strong.
We're pretty confident, and I think what won it for us would have been showing a face of, first of all, a united front between Protestant, Catholic and the centre. Going for this bid.
The city had got behind the bid, and all the citizens were truly and utterly engaged. They really wanted it. We really have transformed ourselves into a very confident city with lots of new opportunities in terms of employment for our citizens.
This little kind of powerhouse of ideas and energy and events, and then from that the city will just be put on this international platform.
The Royal Shakespeare Company,
Turner Prize.
The Royal Ballet.
The biggest Irish language music festival in the world.
Elvis Costello.
A Philharmonic Orchestra from London.
Almost got 141 activities over a 52-week period.
And I believe that next year we're just going to have a consecutive feeling of that kind of enthusiasm and that positivity and that sense of absolute pride in the city. And I think it's just going to grow and grow, and it's going to be fantastic.
So my role for 2013 for the UK City of Culture festivities is... is to look at the Halloween Carnival in Derry and to add new elements to it. It's just a very warm place, full of young creative people. So that tonight, you know, we're looking at how fashion can play a role, and looking at encouraging creative people of the city and further afield to make a real effort with their fashions, with their hair, with their makeup, and just bring some kind of drama and catwalk into it.
But I think in Halloween what you get are the thousands of unsung heroes who all come out onto the streets in Derry for that celebration.
If you don't go out dressed up on Halloween night, you're the odd person out. The overwhelming majority of people will come out dressed up, so it's sort of caught on.
Derry's in a great situation with Halloween that it gets 30,000 people into the city to celebrate it.
We are doing the Banks of the Foyle Halloween Carnival this year with my dance group. Urban Funk. And this year we are going to be dressed as representing water, and we're leading the carnival this year just in front of a big massive boat.
There's more effort that probably goes into our Halloween. I think someone said that thousands of people are going to come over from everywhere just to see the festivities, which that probably speaks for itself as well.
I think that people of considerable influence, mainly in Britain, thought, oh gosh, that would be a good idea. We'll send the City of Culture over to Derry. That'll keep them happy.
I think it presents an incredible opportunity. Whether the city grasps that opportunity or not is very much up in the air at the minute.
As far as we're aware, the head of marketing for UK City of Culture was sacked just a couple of weeks ago, and they felt that he wasn't doing a good enough job.
You only have to look at the branding for City of Culture to see how divided the city is. There are currently 13 logos for City of Culture. There are ones that have UK City of Culture, there are ones that don't have the word UK in it. There are ones that say Derry, Londonderry. There are ones that say Derry. There are ones that say Londonderry. There are ones in Irish.
I suppose it's wrong to make a judgment, an overall judgment of City of Culture at this point, because it hasn't even begun.
the city can't hope to sell itself internationally while all those other things are going on in the background, while it is divided and there's still paramilitary, there's still trouble, there's still kids getting beat up for walking across a bridge. While that goes on, your city, you can fudge it and you can try and cover it up, but those cracks will come through in the end up.
The Bogside Artists in Derry, UK City of Culture, don't exist as far as the City of Culture is concerned. I'll give you another example. I mean, if you're going to talk about fairness, you know, you're going to talk about all-inclusiveness, there is £3 million available to illuminate key historic and heritage sites in this city. That's fact. And what they're going to light up is, of course, the city walls, Lord Craig Evans Bridge, the murals on the Bogside, they stay in the dark. So all these things are going to be lit up and the murals stay in the dark. So the troubles, the conflict, whatever you want to call it, the suffering, pain, the things that shaped us, molded us, made us who we are, that is going to be airbrushed right out of this UK city of culture. We don't exist. The Bogside doesn't exist. And the Bogside artists in particular don't exist. We are a problem for them. We're like a fly on the butter that they think they can swat away.
We're sitting 2 months away from the start of the program. For me, it smells of desperation. But if it works, and if 2013 is successful and delivers the legacy for 2014 and beyond that they're promising, then, you know, it's a small price to pay. And, you know, the hiccups that we're going through now will be soon forgot about.
I believe that there are cynics who are waiting for failure. You know, it's what sells newspapers, it's what makes the radio and TV.
So we have to make sure that it is a party, a celebration of events, that the people in the city that don't have always the means can get access and can attend.
We are in the spotlight, we're the centre of attraction. You know, I think Derry people are a very resilient, a very proud people, very proud of their city, and, you know, very proud of what they've come through, and they're still smiling.
Many people must be responsible for their actions, but going forward, we shouldn't always live in the past. We should learn from that and create something beautiful and something new into the future. So I don't have the scars, but I have the memories of what was.
The City of Culture won't take, you know, isn't going to take away the elements of sectarianism that still exist. It doesn't go into, you know, all of a sudden take away all the hurts and difficulties of the past. It doesn't going to remove all the prejudices and misperceptions and all that sort of stuff. I think what the City of Culture will do, or is doing, it'll take us to a new level. It's a statement that we live in a normal society. The war is over, the conflict is over.